Today, as we continue our series on Bahamian heritage, we will interview the Most Honorable Dr. Hubert A. Minnis, the present Member of Parliament for Killarney and former Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas.
My name is Hubert Alexander Minnis. My date of birth, 16th of April, 1954. My mother's name is Rosalie North. My father's name is Randolph Minnis.
Okay.
I was born in Baintown.
Okay.
Hospital Lane on Dunmore Street.
So and that was your initial home?
Yes. And I lived there until I was about 12 years old. And I subsequently moved to the Grove, which was Exuma Street at that time, opposite Paradise Bakery. And the name of that street has subsequently been changed to Amos Ferguson Street. But I remember a lot about my growing up in Baintown. Those were the most important days for me and the days that I can remember very, very well. I was born a single parent, and my mother used to work. She was what we called at that time a dressmaker. Some refer to it now as seamstress, but she was a dressmaker. And she used to go out and work somewhere off Bay Street, sewing. And she spent a lot of time working. And my second sister, Doris Hall, she would have done a lot of the maternal chores in terms of ensuring that when we came from school, we did our homework, ensuring that we had lunch, we had dinner, etc. So I became very, very close to my sister.
So you said you had a sister named Doris. Did your mother have other children beside you and Doris?
Seven of us.
I didn't realize that.
Two has passed away. Mm-hmm. Doris has passed away. And Cecil, my brother, eldest brother, had just recently passed away. Mm-hmm. It's five of us still. Cheryl, Bertha, Patsy, Cyril, whom they know as Boxer, and myself.
So where did you fall in that group?
I was the last boy.
Okay.
And I was my mother's pet, I would say. I was very attached to my mother. Everywhere she went, I would go. Mm-hmm. And growing up, what I remembered about the community, a lot of times we lived like a community. All in the area were essentially poor.
Mm-hmm. And where exactly was this now, where you grew
this
up?
This was Dunmore Street and Hospital Lane.
Okay.
But we knew everybody in the community. Mm-hmm. And we used to go from yard to yard, play and shoot marbles, mm-hmm. Spin top in the wood, and with the girls we played hopscotch, mm-hmm. and of course jumping jacks, we did all those things. And the homes in those days were built basically off the ground. So we did a lot of activities under the floors, under the ground level,
yeah.
where we would have had what we termed at that time dollhouse, etc., and did a lot of playing, boys and girls things. Mm-hmm. But what was remarkable about growing up is I remembered that we grew up as a community. Many of us within the community did not have much, but we shared a lot. Mm-hmm. So I remember on Sundays especially, you'd have one yard. We'd all meet in one particular yard and we would all eat as a community.
Mm-hmm.
We're not family, but we grew up as families.
Mm-hmm.
And one family may prepare peas and rice. Another family may prepare chicken. Another family may be responsible for beets. Another family may be responsible for corn, potato salad, coleslaw, the mm-hmm. basic family.
So it was a real community.
Yes, and mm-hmm. we shared.
Right.
And we all got enough. Mm-hmm. And obviously the drinks would have been Kool-Aid at that time, mm-hmm. If not then water. And if anyone strange came within the community, we knew.
Mm-hmm.
So robbery, theft, and those things were essentially non-existent at that time.
Right.
And if anyone new came in the community and something was missing, mm-hmm. we knew that there was a new player within the community, and therefore let's zoom in on that play and see if anything there. And my brother and I, we worked while attending school, worked to try and help support the family. And there were several things I did. I remember I used to sell Nassau Guardian. And I'd sell the Guardian every month. I used to buy, at that time, 30 papers. And the newspaper at that time was 10 cents. So it was $3 I'd spend to buy the newspaper.
10 cents.
Mm-hmm. And you'd sell them for 15 cents. So we always made $1.50 profit. And I always sold my route to the Guardian was always there, Thompson Boulevard at the roundabout. And that was my route. I'd just stay there and just sell paper.
Mm-hmm. About how old were you at that time?
I was about 9, 10. And okay. So I'd do that in the morning. Mm-hmm. And then the evening, I would sell the Tribune. Mm-hmm. So we'd go down Tribune there on Shirley Street. Mm-hmm. At that time, the Tribune had a window on the side. Mm-hmm. And you would line up there and you'd say how many papers you want. They would write it down. And then about 2 hours later, they would call you depending on how your name appeared upon your arrival. And they'd say, Minnis 30 and whatever else, and you get your 30 paper.
So were there a lot of newspaper people back then?
Yes, a lot of young boys. A lot of young boys.
Than there are now.
But there were no robbery or anything.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I used to buy 30 newspapers also, mm-hmm. and the Tribune. Again, 10 cents, and you sold for 15 cents and made $1.50. So I'd make $1.50 in the morning, $1.50 in the afternoon. So, you know, you make good money at that time. But what I liked most is on Sundays, I used to shine shoes. Mm-hmm. And we had our route again, and you made more money on shining shoes. I remember a can of polish at that time was about 25 cents. And out of that can of polish, you'd make a minimum of about $10, mm-hmm. you know. And then we used to buy like the whiting, the sole dressing, etc. Mm-hmm.
Well, this was $10? That's good. What
that
year
was
this
good
was?
Money. That would have been in the late 60s.
Okay.
And my route was Hospital Lane. Mm-hmm. So I'd head towards Meeting Street, mm-hmm. and go down on one side of the road, and everybody basically knew who the shoe shine boy was. So they would leave their shoes on the porch, and they'd also leave the money
within the
shoes. And as we passed, as I'm going up towards Meeting Street, mm-hmm. we'd always shout out saying, "Shoe shine, shoe shine." So they know that the shoe shine boy is coming, and they'd put the shoes out. Mm-hmm. So you just walk. You continue walking with your shoe shine box, mm-hmm. and you just walk, shoe shine, shoe shine, shoe shine, shoe shine. And that was the basic hymn mm-hmm. of the shoe shine boy. So walking to Meeting Street, you'd walk on one side, and everybody leave their shoes on the porch. Mm-hmm. If there was not a porch, they left it basically on the steps. And the money was in the shoes. And even if the money was not there, you need not worry. Because by the time you come back the following week, everything is there for you. Mm-hmm. So they just pay you double. And then coming on the return route, my return route would be on the opposite side of Hospital Lane. So you leave from Dunmore Street, head straight up to Meeting Street on the western side of Hospital Lane, mm-hmm. and then you return back on the eastern side.
Okay.
And then on some occasions, you may deviate your route and go different streets. But it was quite safe. So I liked shining mm-hmm. shoes. Then my father had a service station, so I also used to help out there. I used to serve gas.
Was it exactly where the service station is now?
Yes, it hadn't changed.
So it hasn't?
Because I remember when the service station first started. It first started with one pump, and it was called Sinclair Service Station at that time. Mm-hmm. And we used to shine serve gas, and we used to patch tires. Patching tires and machines were not as they are now. Mm-hmm. We used to have what we call a maul or hammer, and some form of gadget you basically bang around the rim, and you take out the tube, repair it, push it back in, and then you have to use the hammer to bang it back on.
Mm-hmm.
And we used to make good tips and everything. Then I attended C.R. Walker School at that time, mm-hmm. Which at that time was called Western Junior.
Mm-hmm.
I attended I used to go to Our Ladies. That's where I first started, Our Ladies School. Now, it's a strange story there. My brother, boxer, who can be somewhat difficult at times, boxer had some altercation there, and they subsequently threw boxer out of Our Ladies. So boxer subsequently went to Western Trinity, was thrown out of school. And then I had not attended church, because you had to attend church. We had to do, there was roll call at church every Sunday. Mm-hmm. I had not attended church for about 3 weeks. Now, I remember I was an altar boy, so I used to attend regularly. Most of the kids in the neighborhood were altar boys.
And what church is what?
Our Ladies, okay. Right there at Bow Street. Mm-hmm. Sydney Poitier's farm across the street, the Majors, etc. Nothing changed. Same families, homesteads and everything are still there. And Boxer was thrown out, and he had to go to Western Junior. I had not attended school for about, church for about 3 weeks, which meant that I had missed roll call. Mm-hmm. When I went to school in the fourth week without attending church, I was sent home and told that my mother had to come in and explain to the headmistress why, and the headmistress at that time was a nun, Sister Richards, why I had not attended church and I could not return to school until my mother explained why I was absent from church and had missed roll call for 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. My mother did not take that lightly, and I would not want to say the words she had, had uttered at that particular time. And because she had refused to go in and explain to Sister Richards why I had not attended church, I could not return to Our Ladies. And therefore, I was sent also to Western Junior, C.R. Walker.
Okay.
Now, Our Ladies would not release my transcript at that time because, as far as they're concerned, there was no reason for me to leave.
Right.
And they were not releasing the transcript. The headmaster at Western Junior at that time was Mr. Boleg, a gentleman from Andres, who knew my father well. And Mr. Boleg, the policy was you could not enter school without a transcript, you moving from one school to another. And because Mr. Boleg knew my father, he said that he would accept me into the school without a transcript. Mm-hmm. And that what they would have to do, because I have no transcript, I would have to be placed in the lowest grade three, because I was moving from Our Ladies grade three to Western. So I would have to be placed in the lowest grade three, and I would have to work myself up. Mm-hmm. Grade three or grade four, one or two. On the second day, they subsequently advanced me. On the fourth day, they advanced me again. And by the following week, I was in the highest grade, grade four. So that's how I worked myself up. And then I wrote the exam for St. Augustine. Mm-hmm. And I passed and went to St. Augustine. Now, going to St. Augustine, we could not afford it. Mm-hmm. We honestly could not afford St. Augustine. It was $70 a semester at that time. And we could not afford it. It was a struggle. And after school, remember, I still was selling my newspaper in the morning. I was still doing my shining shoes. Mm-hmm. Worked at the same station basically only on Saturdays because I was attending school. So service, I still serving gas, patching tires. And I always just saved my money. And every penny I made, I would always give to my mother.
Mm-hmm. I was just going to ask you, what did you do with the money?
No, every penny I made, I would give to her so she would save it for me. Mm-hmm. And if I needed anything, she would purchase it and whatever. So after school, I used to work at least 2 days in a tailor shop on Blue Hill Road, East Street. It was called Morrison Tailor Shop. Near Taylor Street was upstairs, two-story building. Now, Morrison used to cut, and I would just sew, so I never learned how to cut. And it would take you about an hour to make a pants. Mm-hmm. And it would take you about 2 to 3 days to make a coat, because a coat required a lot of padding and infrastructural changes, etc. My pants was very easy. The most difficult part of the pants was the zip and probably the buttonhole, because we had to do it all by hand. There was no fancy machine, whatever. Now for pants, you were paid $1.50 for every pants. Now remember, you could complete a pants in 1 hour. So in 1 hour, you got $1.50. A coat, you would get $2, but a coat took you 3 days. So that made no economic sense to me. So I was not interested in learning how to make coat with all that padding, 3 days for $2, and 1 day, 1 hour for $1.50. So I only made pants. And then even
can you make pants today?
No, I can repair, but okay. I can repair. And I would still do, I would still sew even today. Even today, my pants or any tear or anything, or even sometimes the kids needed their pants cuffing. I used to do all that because, you know, I became good at it, whatever else. And I had. And then my mother, because she was a seamstress, a dressmaker, parents always want one of their kids to follow them. And because I was interested in sewing, she got me my own sewing machine, which was a Singer sewing machine. So I used to sew, and of course, she would make my shirts and stuff to go to school.
So who owned that store? The
Morrison. I know it was Morrison Taylor Shop. Yeah, okay. It was Bahamian. Mm-hmm. All Bahamians. St. Augustine, I used to get sent home every semester, because they used to do roll call and intercom, and my school fees were always late. So you'd be called, you know, the intercom would come on. So the following students, please report to the headmaster's office. And then was three names they always called. I was in room 51, and there were three names they always called. I wouldn't call the names at this time. But, and
it was... He was one of them.
Yeah, it was tradition. Room 51, you know, announcements in room 51, the following students, please report to the headmaster's office. Hubert Minnis, so and so, and we'd go. And then we'd disappear because we sent home. School fees were not paid. And it became a point. But at that, up to that point, I still did not understand what poverty was. Because as far as I'm concerned, I was breathing fresh air, I was living, I was playing just like everyone else. I was enjoying myself, and I was eating, you know, and I had fun. I attended movies, and, you know. So I never really understood what poverty was. And it came home one day in St. Augustine, when we were in the home, and they announced, well, the following students, please report to the headmaster's office. And a student who was still living today, a very outstanding student, before our names were announced, he said, Minnis, so-and-so, you all might as well get up and go. Before the names were announced. It was then that I understood what poverty was. And I then said to my mother that, listen, we can't afford it. You know, I don't want to go back. This was then grade three. Form three. It was forms at that time. And Grand Bahama was opening up Freeport. And I told her, listen, it's best for me to drop out because we can't afford it. And Cheryl, who was the last one, I said, you know, let us work and concentrate on her so that she could get the education as opposed to me, you know, because we don't have sufficient for all of us. So let's concentrate on Cheryl. And she insisted, no, you were not going to drop out. You were going to continue. We don't care. We'll make it work. She wanted me to be her first child to attend university. And I must continue. So I used to go to Grand Bahama in the summer, and I worked. And while in Grand Bahama, I used to work laying carpets. And,
so how did and you get to go to Grand Bahama? Like,
well, the eldest brother, because Grand Bahama was doing well, you could have gotten 2-3 jobs at Grand Bahama.
But
Wow. He determined that it was best to help the family. Mm-hmm. It was best that he go where there was great job opportunity, and he would send money back to help the family, to help us all. Okay. And so I used to go there in the summer, and I worked. So laying carpets and drapery, I used to be paid $99 per week. I remember that very well. Mm. And the hotel that I worked on in Grandmama was called International Hotel. I remember that very well. So all the carpets and the drapery I would have laid there. So, but what is amazing, in St. Augustine, when I graduated, we had the school magazine. And in the school magazine, we used to have, the students used to vote on certain factors or elements for students. And so we'd have like most intelligent boy. Mm-hmm. And I always remember Philip Galanis, who was an accountant today, was voted most intelligent boy in the school.
Was he in your class?
Yes.
Okay.
Bendick Dorset was voted best athlete. And he became the vice principal of the school. Then there was this girl, Corita Wells. I don't know where she is today. She was voted most intelligent female. Mm-hmm. And surprising to me, I didn't understand what it meant anyhow at that time. I was voted most likely to succeed.
Oh, wow.
That was by my peers at that particular time. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, they would have seen something to me that I hadn't seen, because I was not the brightest in the class and whatever.
No.
Plus, remember, I used to spend a lot of time away from school because, you know, I couldn't afford it and whatever else. So,
your grades at that time weren't exceptional?
No, my grades were B and C.
Okay.
Occasionally, I got A. Mm-hmm. I remember one semester, it was very strange, you know. Math, I got A. Then the following semester, I got F. Then the following semester, I got A. Then the next semester, I got F. Then the following semester, I got A. Mm-hmm. So the teacher said, obviously, once he applies himself, he does it. And when he finds himself in a lull, then he applies himself and he goes back up to the top. But St. Augustine, I think, was the best school for me at that time. Mm-hmm. And why? Because school came out. We used to go in at 8 o'clock at that time. And I used to hike to school and then ride bicycle. With all the monies that I made from tailoring, from sewing and selling
newspapers
and shoes and shiny shoes. And with assistance from mother and father, bought a Playboy bicycle, so I used to ride sometime also. But after you leave school, there was not an academic or studying environment at your home. You didn't have proper lighting. You had no desk to study. You had no chair or anything to study. There was nobody to supervise you or anything. My sister Doris, she used to assist and make sure we did our homework as best she can. But remember, she also was a student. In her, a student herself, and she had to do homework also. So, because St. Augustine came out at 5, so between 2 and 5, you had what you call a study period, where you had supervision to assist you with your homework, etc. So by the time you leave school, your homework and your studies are completed, which was perfect for us coming from the inner city in a poor environment, in a non-studious environment. Mm-hmm. So you were in an environment in school where you could complete all this. And then you had also an additional hour, what you call after school play.
Right.
So you have recreation, athletic events, sporting activity, etc. So you had a round education. But when I look at it today, the most important part of my education in St. Augustine was that staying behind that 2 to 5 segment in St. Augustine's, because we did not have a studious environment or an academic environment to do any homework. You studying to what you call candlelight, or you had the kerosene lamp, which was strenuous at that time also. And you didn't have any chair. You had to sit at the dining room table, and sometimes you may sit on the porch doing homework because you don't have the environment. Nobody to assist you or whatever. And so I thought that was the most important part mm-hmm. of my academic or my education.
So in talking about that house, is the house still there that you lived in?
No, the house has been broken down and something else is being built there. Now, what is being built there? That was being built there for the past 20 odd years. I mean, it's never been finished.
So
every
what
time
did
I
the
pass,
house,
I would look.
Can you describe the house, how it
was? It was a wooden structure. Mm-hmm. It was a two-story wooden structure, because I remember you walk upstairs, and it had like a porch,
mm-hmm.
Porch downstairs, porch upstairs. We lived downstairs. Mm-hmm. Someone else lived upstairs.
So you were renting, or?
Yes. Yes. Okay. We were renting.
Did you not have electricity?
No.
Did you have inside?
No, we didn't have water, but we had outdoor toilet too. Outdoor toilet, oh. And we used to bathe in the toilet. Outdoor toilet, we had the metal tubs, mm-hmm. and we take the tub in the toilet and bathe there. Sometimes it happened, you take the tub in the kitchen, and the boys were responsible for going to the pump, get the water and whatever, and fill the tub with water. And then if it's very cold, we use the boil the water.
So you have warm water.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And the soap at that time was Lifebuoy soap. It was a red soap.
Carbolic.
Lifebuoy.
That is leave your skin white.
Yeah. So we used to bathe with Lifebuoy. So mm-hmm. in many instances, mm-hmm. you put the tub in the kitchen, mm-hmm. and the girls would bathe there. In many instances, boys, you know, we really didn't care. We weren't mm-hmm. ashamed or anything. So the tub, we put the tub in the yard. We put the water in the yard, and we bathe in the yard.
Right.
But the metal silver tubs.
Mm-hmm. So you said this was in on Dunmore Street?
Dunmore and Hospital Lane, yeah.
It was on a corner?
Yeah. Dunmore Street runs east to west.
Mm-hmm.
If you're familiar with Dunmore Street, and as that hit Blue Hill Road, just on the eastern side of Blue Hill Road, it's a one-story old wooden building. That was what you call the Elks of St. George at that particular time.
Mm-hmm.
And Hospital Lane basically runs north to south, so it's where they intersect each other.
Okay. Yeah, so that's the old stomping ground. Yeah, Hospital Lane is actually very familiar to me.
Yeah.
Okay, so you talked about your parents. Did you have aunts and uncles? Did you know your mother's sisters and brothers? Did she have sisters?
Yes, I knew all of my mother's sisters and brothers. I knew all my mother's sisters.
Are they still alive?
The last sister died several years ago. The last sister was Grace. She lived Hospital Peter Street.
Mm-hmm.
She lived in the homestead of my grandmother, because I used to go to my grandmother also on Saturdays, and I used to love going to my grandmother.
What was her name?
She was Justina Mackey.
Okay.
But
that was your mother's mother.
That's right. We used to call her Mom B.
Mm-hmm.
And on Saturday was what you call South Day, and she used to bake bread. And you'd have put chicken sauce, not chicken sauce, pig feet sauce.
Mm-hmm.
So Saturday is sauce day. Now my grandmother, I used to like going to my grandmother because my grandmother was interesting. You know, I used to like asking her questions about the past, about her parents and her mother, her father, what was it like her growing up. And she'd always tell me that how her parents were slaves. And so I learned a lot about slavery and what they used to do. So I used to enjoy sitting down and learning those things from my grandmother. But I'd always remember on Saturdays, my grandmother would send us to buy bread. Sometimes she may not have, you know, because she used to bake the bread in the outdoor, in the oven in the yard, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And if she don't have sufficient bread, she'd send us to Purity Bakery.
Mm-hmm.
Now there was a store almost opposite where Southern Police Station is.
Mm-hmm.
And that store, that was owned by a lady we used to call Mama Lou. Now, Mama Lou sold bread, but Mama Lou's bread was 30 cents. And Purity Bakery, same location where it's at now, it used to be around the corner as opposed to on the main road, because on the main road was the capital theater,
mm-hmm.
but Purity bought the entire complex eventually. Purity If you bent the purity, you bought the bread for 28 cents. Mm. And you got it from Mama Lou. No, you bought it at purity, yeah, for 28 cents. And Mama Lou, which was right across the street from us, was 30 cents.
Was it the same bread?
Same bread. So my grandmother would insist that we go into purity and bring her 2 cents change to her. Mm-hmm. So because I used to sell newspaper and shine shoe, I said, man, there's no way I'm walking all the way up there by the Capitol Theater purity to save 2 cents. So I just used to go in my little kitty and go to Mama Lou, pay the extra 2 cents, you know, mm-hmm. and basically give my grandmother her 2 cents change, because mm-hmm. there's no way I was going to walk all the way to purity.
So Purity Bakery really has a history. Were the owners the same back then? I would think
not. I never knew who owned Purity. Yeah. The owners were not the same, mm-hmm. because there's a different grouping bought it. I remember that. It was sold a different grouping. Mm-hmm.
So your grandmother, I'm sure she's not alive
anymore. No, she's passed away. She's from Long Island, mm-hmm. Clarencetown, Long Island.
Really? Yeah. So where was your mother from? Was she from?
My mother was from here. My grandfather, he was from Scotland, and it's in Ireland. He was a North. He was a white man. I never knew him.
Mm-hmm. So he died? Or he was
died when my mother was 5. Oh. So she used to tell me about him, tell mm-hmm. all us about him. And we would have had pictures about him and everything. But he used to, he was a businessman. Mm-hmm. He was well off at that time, from my understanding, from my mother. And he used to make, or what they used to say, roll cigars, and he had his own business and whatever. But I only would have learned about him from my mother when I asked mm-hmm. her. But I was more interested in the history from my grandmother. So I used to like go there mm-hmm. and get all the information from her. Mm-hmm. But then in her, as she got older, Alzheimer's, as we know it today, started to set in. In those days, we used to say Grammy Doughton, man, Grammy Doughton, you know, because mm-hmm. you'd ask her a question, and, you know, she in left field, mm-hmm. and you say, Charlie, I ain't going by Mambe today, man. Mambe Doughton, man, every time you ask her something, she in left field, whatever. Mm-hmm. But today it's called Alzheimer's, but in those days we used to say
you didn't Doughton, know, yeah. You know? Okay. So your father's family, did you know much of them? Did you know?
No, I didn't know my father's family until late. Mm-hmm. Because I was more attached to my mom. Mm-hmm. And I used to go everywhere with my mom. Mm-hmm. My brother and sister were more attached to him. And they knew his family mm-hmm. a lot better. I got to know them as I got older mm-hmm. and started to move away from my mother a little, but she was very, very protective of me, and we had a special relationship.
Right.
We had a special relationship. Everywhere she went, I would go with her, and so there was a special relationship between her, my sister Doris, who died, and my mother. So I've always viewed Doris as my second mother. Because she used to do everything for us.
I never really knew that you had that she had that many children. I always thought it was like 3 or 4.
No, 7.
The number of you.
Yeah, 7.
Okay. So now, after you left high school, in fact, what year did you leave high school? What year did you finish?
I finished high school in 1971. Mm-hmm. And we had to write what was then SAT. And I got accepted into university in Minnesota. I got accepted at St. Thomas University. You know, most students from St. Augustine go either St. Thomas, St. John's. So I accepted into St. Thomas University. And school fees were paid by my father, my mother. All of us used to scrap and whatever else. And I would also run some form of reduction also in school fees. Mm-hmm. And while there, I used to work also. I spent 1 year at St. Thomas University and then subsequently transferred to University of Minnesota. Mm-hmm. And at University of Minnesota, well, obviously, I had to used to come home. I had gotten a job. Mm-hmm. So I used to work in the lab doing nuclear physics learning.
Mm-hmm. And this was
working with atoms. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's at University of Minnesota.
So what did you major in?
I majored in biology. Mm-hmm. And so I used to work after school there, but it was very organized. So, because we were studying atoms, I just had to go in the lab and do certain works on atoms. So I'd just go and do one hour during school hours, and then work also after school. Mm-hmm. And used to save money, and that would help and whatever. And then they used to have what they call the foreign. Used to have
an ability to make money for foreign students.
Yeah, they had groupings or organizations that used to try out foreign students, and used to take advantage of all those. And after I finished University of Minnesota, I applied. Well, it's very interesting about medical school. My mother wanted me to do medicine. My mother and my sister Doris. I didn't want to do medicine. I was afraid of medicine because the teachers had drilled in our head that only A students can become doctor, nothing less. And therefore I had a great phobia. I had a great fear that I could not succeed, and I would not accept failure as a part of my forte. And I applied for medical school while in the third year of my university, and I was accepted. But I turned it down because, you know, I was frightened, really. I was frightened that I wouldn't succeed. And then because I used to attend summer school, I was finishing early, so I subsequently took on another major. So I did, my major was biology, mm-hmm. and my minor was black history, and that would have come from my grandmother. I used to learn so much from her. I wanted to learn a lot more about black history. Mm-hmm. So that was my minor. And after I finished university, I came home to Nassau. My mother asked me if I had applied to medical school, and I said, no, I really don't want to go. Mm-hmm. And she said, apply to medical school. So her and my sister, she sat me down. The deadline for the application had already passed. So I still completed it, sent it in. And they accepted me again. Mm-hmm. And I still didn't want to go. And well, even before I had applied to medical school, my mother made me apply also to, I think it was University of Miami and some other institution, because I wanted to do marine biology. That's what I really wanted to do. I thought the sea was the future of the world, and I wanted to be a part of that. And I never heard from the U.S. in terms of marine biology. And that's when they said, well, apply to medical school. And I said, well, the deadline has already passed. They're not going to. So they said, no, apply. Mm-hmm. So they said, we just don't want you here in Nassau. Because once you stay and you start working and you get accustomed to what money is worth and what money can do and what you can do with money, you're not going to go back off to school. You're going to stay. So we want you to go off. So I applied to medical school, Jamaica, and I got accepted. And I went. And I went there with this great fear that medical school was very difficult, and you know, and myself, Robin Roberts, and a few other Bahamian students. So because of that phobia, mm-hmm. and that drilling in my head by my teachers, mm-hmm. that only A students, only the brightest, mm-hmm. can make it, you know, I started studying what we used to term at that time, hitting the books. So I started studying from day one. And then I realized that medical school was easy. I said, Jesus, it's not as difficult as they said. Mm-hmm. And I just got to like it, and I found it very, very easy. So when people ask me, how do you compare medical school with university? I say, university is much more difficult than medical school, because in university, you may have to read one or two books, which may be very complex. Medical school, on the other hand, you may have to read 10 books, which are simple, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of logistics. So I always compared medical school basically as an extension of high school, in that it's the volume that kills you, not the complexity. Mm-hmm. But the university, it's the complexity that kills you, not the volume.
Right, okay. All right. So how old were you when you went to medical school? Do you remember?
Mm. I was probably about 20, mm-hmm. 20, 21.
So you were still young. Yeah. Back in them days, you thought you were old, but that was young.
Yeah, I was 20, okay. 21 when I went into mm-hmm. medical school. But I'll give you another segment.
Yeah. And then...
Because there's an interesting history about... And I'll talk about it another time. But it's an interesting history. After I completed medical school, well, first of all, I got a, what you call a loan scholarship from the government. And the government at that time was $1,500 per year. And obviously, Robin Roberts and I, but I'll talk about all this part later because it's a very interesting history, especially the history when I came and did my internship and wanted to go back to school. Mm-hmm. Because surprisingly, Perry Christie was Minister of Health at that time.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
And it'd be interesting for me to go into mm-hmm. it because I would have had interviews with him and everything and, mm-hmm. you know, explaining to him that I wanted to go off for training and whatever else and his response and everything. But that's another day. That's a long story.
Okay, well. So it's really very interesting because I learned some things about you today that I never knew. And I am sure there is a lot more to talk about. So maybe we could end it here and pick it up another day.
Thank you okay. very much. Thank you very much.